Welcome to the Woodridge Audio Project. I'm David, or Dave if you prefer, from audioprojectcentral.com, and I'm hosting the Woodridge Audio Project. This episode of the Woodridge Audio Project is part of the uplifting, informative, and I'm sure you will agree, inspirational series of character profiles of different people at the school. Please share the episodes with your friends and your family via your social media or in whatever ways you can think of, even if that means emailing a link to someone. You can find out more about Woodridge or contact a member of the team by visiting www.woodridge.co.za. The guest for this episode is Mr. Kuhle Sonkosi, a rugby coach and teacher at Woodridge, and he begins the interview by talking a bit about his background.
I was a professional rugby player for about 5 years when I finished school. Yeah, then 2015, my contract came to an end and I sort of had to try and figure out what was next. I was torn between carrying on to go play rugby and then obviously trying to move around. Should I get a contract or do I follow a new passion, which was coaching, and something that I fell in love with while still playing. And I got an opportunity to come to Woodridge to come and coach. It was probably the best thing for me, you know, because I came here to coach and then studied teaching and changed my life for that.
Where do you think that the change of attitude from professional rugby player to possible teacher and then teacher, where do you think that switchover occurred?
I think it switched over when I got here. You know, I came here just to come coach rugby. And then you started working in the environment. You started seeing teachers, being in a classroom, being away from the rugby field as well, and seeing the other aspects of school. And I fell in love with that. You know, I love being in the classroom. I love being with the kids. Also, just not just on the field, just away from the field and getting to know them. And I think the fact is also I stayed on campus and get to meet the boarders, get to meet the hostel kids, and that changed from there. It's just switched like almost immediately from I don't just want to coach, I actually want to be a teacher. I want to help kids and teach as well.
Do you think there's something in that clash between competition and cooperation? The one environment that you were in was pretty competitive, professional rugby, and then the one that you found yourself coaching in is way more cooperative and constructive. Do you think there's anything in that?
Yeah, definitely. So for me, I've tried to mesh the two, you know, especially with the coaching. I've tried to find a way to balance the cooperation with competition. And so that's been something that I've tried to find the balance on. I think obviously I came from a massive competition-based background where it was when now if you can't perform, someone else will come in and you sort of want instant results and instant gratification. Whereas one thing I learned at Woodridge, you know, it's trying to get more cooperation from kids and trying to get more out of them and using ways to try to get them more cooperative. And also, and what I realized is the more cooperation you got for them, the better results that came with it. So for me, I was trying to find a way that balances cooperation and competition. I think we at Woodridge, it's something I'm still striving to do. I think I've gotten a lot better after 5 years. I think I'm better at it now than I was at the start.
And looking back at that 5-year period, do you have any highlights that stand out?
How much time do you have? Being able to coach first in rugby start, that was a dream come true for me. It's just seeing kids just being successful, you know. You'll see a kid, for example, you play with the grade ones, you can't even, at the beginning of the year, couldn't catch tennis ball. And then come the end of the term, you see the satisfaction there when they can catch. You see the satisfaction when some kids, you know, they're just struggling with math problems or struggling with classwork, and then you're seeing their growth from the start of the year to the end of the year. You get a little thank you from the kids, and, you know, it's just like small things like that. I've been here long enough now where I've seen kids go from primary school and turn into head boys and head girls, and you see them pretty much grow up in front of your own eyes. You see kids now, you know, like the kids I work with now, the matric students I work with, they were in grade 7 when I got here, and now some of them are head boys and they're leaders of the school, and they're making their next steps for the future. And just being able to see that every day and working with that, there's so many highlights, you know. Like, I don't look at like individual things, like, yeah, obviously there's great seasons and great classes, but for me it's just a constant growth in seeing the kids grow every year.
So you are also something of a YouTube personality. You're a content creator. I've seen some of that stuff. It's really good. I'd like to know,
thank you,
do you think that there's any rub off from that part of your profile onto the students and pupils? Do you think that they're learning something indirectly through what you've done in your own time and your own comedy? And what do you think they're taking from that?
I hope so. The biggest thing for me has been, it's something that I love. It's a passion of mine, you know, making people laugh. And the thing I want to try to get to the kids is, you know, they ask me like all the time, like, so like, how can we do something like that? And I say, guys, it's not don't follow my path. Do something that you love. That's anything that's what made me do the videos. You know, it's something I love. I love making people laugh. I love entertaining people. That's my personality. I try and bring that to work and in everything that I do every day. What's made it successful is that it's authentic. And I try to tell the kids that, listen, whatever you do, make it authentic. Make it you. Whether it's you love accounting, make it you. Whether you love singing, post about it. Make it something that's authentic. Make it you. It's not. It doesn't have to be a cliche. You don't have to follow a certain path that because one person does it this way. So that's what I try and get to the kids. You know, I try and tell them, you know, like if you like being on social media, then do it. It's something that you love. It's your passion, then do it. And you don't have to have one passion. That's my biggest motto I love. But like, you don't have to just be a teacher. You don't just have to be an 18-year-old student. You don't just have to be a doctor. You can be a doctor who loves comedy, a doctor who goes home and plays the guitar and goes, but like, I try to get the kids to enjoy life and just do whatever you can. Yeah.
Is there anything that you would be happy to tell me and listeners that nobody else would know about you?
I think I'm very shy. People think I'm not shy. So I put it like, I got like a front that I put on. That's my internet face and I'm around people. But I get nervous speaking in front of people. One thing about me is I'm very passionate with people. I love people. And I love spending time with people. I love knowing people. I love growing with people. That's something that when people get to know me a lot more, they see that behind the cameras, behind when I'm in the classroom, you see the shyness and you also understand how much I love people and just seeing people grow, which is something that I'm a big believer in, and seeing, I got a motto I live by it. If I win, my friends have got to win as well, you know, making sure that we all grow together and finding ways that we can all be successful. So, and besides teaching, I said, I can be shy, loyal, try to be loyal as I can. And just love people.
Do you have any recommendations on books, films, podcasts, anything really that listeners might be interested in? And why would you recommend it?
I always feel like, you know, people look at their own passions. So for me, I'm a sports guy. So I listen to a whole bunch of sports podcasts, you know, some things that I enjoy, leadership podcasts. I do enjoy Craig Rochelle's leadership podcasts and trying to become a better leader. What I always advise people in, you know, like I never say, go watch this or read this book or read that. What I tend to do is like, if you have a passion for something, do as much research and as much groundwork as you can, as you possibly can. If you love business, spend time watching business podcasts. Spend time reading as much as you can. Spend time doing as much research as you can. Almost immerse yourself in that world, you know, like with sports and comedy. That's what I try to do, you know. I try to immerse myself in that world. If I'm not thinking about sport, I'm watching sport. If I'm not thinking about comedy, I'm watching comedy. I'm always trying to watch, okay, what sort of video can I do next? What sort of work can I do next? Okay, the rugby side, how can I improve them? Do I need to go and search on YouTube to find something to improve these results? Do I need to go and study something? Do I need to go on a course to go and figure out how can I fix this thing? So whatever it is you do, do it properly.
You've mentioned some fairly consuming contexts, like online context seems all-encompassing. That drive that you're describing to do things properly and really dive into the deep end of whatever you're passionate in. How do you think the sporting context in your own life and at Woodridge helps you achieve a balance that seems to lack in other people's lives? People who get too far into like the business mindset or the online context.
Balance is what you said. That's for me, that's the key word. Playing sports, professional sports, it taught me to have a balance between being on the rugby field, being with friends, being giving myself time off to find myself as well. And also find time to pursue other passions. You know, I was a bit younger then when I got to Woodridge. The first thing I did, I found myself that I sort of shut down everything else. And then I was just focusing on the teaching and focusing on the coaching. And I figured out I was not as happy as I wanted to be. So and then now with the videos, it's something that I said, okay, I need to find a balance and be able to use. I don't have to just be a teacher. I can use things. I can use that as a tool. I'm very process driven. So the way I teach is trying to find the right processes to get performance. When I'm doing my comedy, what's my processes into finding a video? How can I get my processes right to get the performance and the desired performance from it? And that's a sporting thing which has helped me is the fact that to want results and to want a level of high quality performance, but at Woodridge is finding out the right processes to achieve that and finding the right processes and being able to find the boxes to tick in order to get that high quality of performance. So I do believe it would is my processes have become a lot better, and in result, the performances and the teaching and the coaching and the comedy have become a lot better. It's sort of spun off with each other.
And that brings us to the end of the interview. Thanks for listening, and please do remember to share the episodes and relevant social media posts with your friends and family, and like the episodes at whichever social media platform you found them on. If you have any follow-up questions, head over to www.woodridge.co.za, where you will find the contact details for the school, and you can contact me at www.audioprojectcentral.com.